And my dear students participants, on behalf of Hubli Women's College, I, Madhushree Bhoumik, Department of Nutrition, welcome you all for today's webinar on Food for Life, Nutrition Strategies to Prevent Diseases, which is organized by Department of Nutrition. May I request to IQAC coordinator and also advisor of the webinar, Dr. Shyamalina Goswami ma'am, to give welcome address to this occasion.
Thank you, Madhushree, for your nice introduction. Hello, everyone. Very good morning and welcome to the 2 days national level webinar on Food for Life, Nutrition Strategies to Prevent Diseases, hosted by Department of Nutrition in association with Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Hubli Women's College. It gives me immense warmth and tremendous contentment to be presenting the welcome speech amongst the most esteemed personalities who have won accolades in their respective fields, the speakers, the faculties, the scholars, and the students. We all know that good nutrition is one of the key to healthy life, but there are loads of conflicting nutrition and diet advice all around. So I really feel that the topic of the webinar is not only thought-provoking, but topic of the nation's, topic of the present time. And presentations will enrich us how to stick to that type of diet, which is good for one's mind and body. Your active participation is important throughout the sessions. Once again, I would like to welcome all for finding time and visiting 2 days national level webinar. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam, for your encouraging words. Now, I request to our principal madam and patron of the webinar, Dr. Seema Banerjee madam, to address her inaugural speech. Hello, madam.
Sorry, disturbance was in the internet connection. Please let me
now. I request to our principal and patron of the webinar, Dr. Seema Banerjee madam, to address her inaugural speech.
Thank you, Madhushree. Thanks to all the participants who are assembled here to listen to a 2 day seminar on Food for Life, Nutrition Strategies to Prevent Diseases, organized by the Department of Nutrition, Hubli Women's College, West Bengal, India. We are passing through an unforeseen situation of the society. COVID-19 compelled us to face a threat of life. So all we have to be conscious about our diet for this passing phase. Because we all know that only good and balanced diet can protect us against this pandemic, raising the immunity power of our body. All we are assembled here to listen from eminent speakers from different institutes all over India dealing with the subject of food science and nutrition. It's the science of food and health. Nutrition is a fundamental requirement for positive health. Good nutrition is an important part to lead a healthy life. Food choices make a huge impact on health. The right diet can help the against any type of illness, such as heart diseases, diabetes, osteoporosis, cancer, so on and so forth. So it is important to take a balanced diet, rich in all nutrients, to ensure that no deficiencies or hormonal imbalances can be created in the body. It boosts immunity and gives the ability to fight against diseases. Now I'm handing over the speaker to Madhushree again. Please, Madhushree, carry on.
Thanks to our beloved principal madam for your encouraging words. We are going to start our first technical session of this webinar. We have two invited lectures in this session. Now, it's a great pleasure for me to introduce our keynote speakers. We are honored to have Dr. Asna Uruj and Dr. Neelam Yadav with us today. Our first honorable speaker, Dr. Asna Uruj, is going to talk about dietary advanced glycation in products, AGE, and their relevance to human health. Professor Asna Uruj is chairperson of the Postgraduate Department of Studies in Food Science and Nutrition, University of Mysore, Mysore, India. Her areas of research interest are diabetes, starch digestibility and glycemic responses, nutritional antioxidants, chemically of applications, anti-hyperglycemic and hypolipidemic effects of medicinal plants, disease-specific food formulations, and women's health and nutritional issues. She has completed 14 research projects funded by UGC, DST, MHRD, and BBSRC UK. She serves as a reviewer and editor for several national and international journals. She has 185 research papers published in peer-reviewed journals with 3,359 citations and H index of 28, ITN index of 72. 18 candidates have completed PhD while 8 are working. She is a recipient of the prestigious Dr. Kalpana Chawla State Award 2009 for Young Women Scientist. Professor G.S. Bain's Lifetime Achievement Award 2011, bestowed by Association of Food Scientists and Technologists, and Dr. Rajammal Devdas Oration Award conferred by Nutrition Society of India 2017 for her outstanding achievement and contribution in nutritional sciences, has received Young Scientist Award and 44 Best Paper Awards. She was the first president of Indian Dietetic Association, Mysore chapter, and member of Registered Dietitian Board of Indian Dietetic Association. She has been a member of FASI Committee on Functional Foods and currently in the working group for HFSS, High Fat Sugar and Salt, and FOPL Front of Pack Labeling. During deputation as Deputy Registrar in the University of Mysore, she has been responsible in establishing Human Ethics Committee and IPS cell. Now, I request Dr. Asna Uruj ma'am to kindly deliver her talk. It is over to you, ma'am. Ma'am?
Hello, ma'am.
Ma'am, please unmute your microphone. You are visible, completely visible, but please unmute your microphone.
Ma'am, if you are logged in through a desktop or laptop, then in your laptop screen, below your laptop screen, you can see an option. If this is not working right, you can...
Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
can you
ma'am.
Hear
sure,
me?
Sure.
Now it's
yes,
working.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, yes, ma'am. Absolutely.
I just want to put on the PPT. Well, at the outset, a very good morning to everyone. And I'm very thankful to the principal, Dr. Banerjee of Hooghly Women's College for having considered me to deliver a talk in this e-conference, which has been organized by Hooghly Women's College. And I'm also thankful to Dr. Majumdar, who has contacted and taken a lot of effort in coordinating this whole event. And thank you, Ms. Madhushree, for the nice introduction. Oh, well, we are all going through. Can you see my PPT? Hello. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Well, we are all going through a very, a very traumatic phase of COVID-19. And along with that, it has brought in a lot of changes in our lifestyle. So it is very imminent for us to understand what goes on in our body due to the impact of certain diseases or deficiencies or viral infections. I'm not talking today on about COVID, but I thought of speaking on a newer topic, dietary advanced glycation end products and their relevance for human health. Well, at the outset, I bring greetings from my 100-year-old University of Mysore. These are just glimpses of the university office and the entrance of the university. Now, throughout my next 40 minutes of talk, I will be discussing under three or four sections to wind up with solutions. The first thing is, like, what are the anti-glycation, advanced glycation end products in foods? And do we really consume these AGEs? The short form for this advanced glycation end products is AGEs. And do we consume, and if at all they are present, how are they formed, and what is the approx amount of these advanced glycation end products in our diet? Then how do they contribute to the endogenous level, and what is their impact on health? And finally, do we have any solutions for them? So let's come to the first section, wherein, as I said, occurrence of AGEs in foods and the daily uptake of AGEs. Okay, now age, we all know, all of us are aging from the moment we are born, but this advanced glycation end products are different. They are diet derived, and let us try and understand what are these AGEs and how are they formed. We all know, all food scientists are familiar with the Maillard reaction, which takes place between the sugars and the proteins, that is the amino group of proteins or amino acids, and this does not involve any enzymatic process. It's a non-enzymatic process, and the glycation results in the formation of age products. Okay, now, so these advanced glycation end products are formed endogenously also in the human body. Exogenously, they are formed when foods are subjected to heat, particularly high heat, which we shall see later. In contrast to endogenous ages, dietary ages, they are formed in much higher extent. That is as an impact of different kinds of cooking procedures and processing conditions. So the correct definition for ages is advanced glycation end products. These are complex oxidant compounds created when simple sugars cross-link with proteins or lipids through non-enzymatic reaction. As a food scientist student, we have all studied about Maillard products, which contribute to the generation of flavoring and color and nice aroma. Besides that, it also will result in the formation of certain heterocyclic aromatic amines and even carcinogenic acrylamide. The reaction initiates formation of highly reactive aldehydes, which further react with biomolecules to form different types of advanced glycation end products like carboxymethyllysine or carboxyl ethyl lysine, pyrrolidine, then hydroxymethyl imidazoline ornithine. These are the various groups of AGEs which scientists have identified. Now, in this picture, we can see the depiction of Maillard reaction. It could be a piece of bread or any food which has been exposed to high temperature over a longer duration of time, gets some kind of an appearance, and this is because of the interaction, Maillard reaction between the sugars and the amino group of protein or amino acids. Now, the Maillard reaction is necessary because it can give us that typical color. You want your bread to be brown, or you want a typical flavor, but at the same time, it also results in the formation of certain products like, you know, CEL, CML, MG, and pyrrolidine, etc. So in the body also, ages are formed. Now here also, this figure depicts the formation of the ages in the human body. Like, you know, the glucose which is in circulation can also result in Schiff's-Bayes reaction and can result in the formation of advanced glycation end products. Then as a result of glycolytic intermediates, then as a result of lipid peroxidation. So these are the other sources how the ages can be formed in our body. Now we are familiar with one more terminology like glycation and glycosylation. Okay, so what is glycation and what is glycosylation? This is for the benefit of students. Now glycation, as I told you, is a non-enzymatic reaction between sugar and free amino group of protein or amino acid, whereas glycosylation is an enzymatic reaction between same substrates like sugar and protein or organic molecules. And glycation contributes to flavor, aroma and color of the food. In the bloodstream too, glycation takes place. We are all familiar with the glycated hemoglobin, which serves as a biomarker in diabetes. The glycation process can be considered pathological because it results in the formation of age products which cross-link with other proteins, lipids and render them inactive. Whereas glycosylation is physiological. So let us try and understand what are the sources of age. Now see, since diet is the single greatest source of age products, we need to understand what contributes. How can diet contribute to these advanced glycation end products? See, it is not so much what we eat, but how it is prepared. Like, you know, what procedure are you using? How much flame, whether it is low flame or high flame, high temperature, short time, what kind of processing you are using matters for the generation of age. Foods which are higher in fat and protein, like meat and cheese, they invariably result in higher advanced glycation end products. And in general, cooking at a higher temperature creates higher levels of ages. Besides diet, cigarette smoking is number two producer or source of age, and internal glycation also is one of the source of age. Okay, so hence it is suggested that we should avoid high sugar foods. Now the question then arises is, do advanced glycation end products contribute to body's age pool? Is there a pool in the body? Yes, there is a lot of convincing evidence suggesting that dietary ages are absorbed in the digestive tract and they circulate in the bloodstream until they are eliminated in the urine. Today, we don't have a foolproof mechanism to understand the metabolism of age. But however, from the available literature, it has been possible to come up with a suggestion. So what could be the fate of consumed ages in the human body? So let us begin here, absorption. Assuming that we consume high age products, 30% of them may be absorbed. Okay, it is suggested. Then 2/3 of the consumed ages can circulate either free or they can be bound to a protein. And this is how they circulate in the bloodstream. It's surprisingly, in diabetics, the age products have got a longer half-life. And among the 4 or 5 different types of age products, pyrrolidine is known to accumulate and it is known to degrade to some unknown metabolites. And there are two ways how these end products are excreted. One is the fecal route and another is the urinary route. See, fecal excretion takes place wherein the excretion of unabsorbed ages, or even they may be subjected to microbial degradation. This is only a suggestion. And the urinary excretion, 1/3 of the consumed will be eliminated in urine in healthy subjects. In diabetics, it is said to be less than 5%. And most of the end product, what is eliminated in urine, is the pyrrolidine metabolites. So do we have databases? Like, do we have the reported content of ages in various foods? Because foods are manufactured, they are processed, they are cooked in a variety of ways, which differs from home to home and from factory to factory, and depending on the food product. So the processes differ. So yes, we do have some databases. Let me talk about that. First, ages have been analyzed in a broad range of food products. Okay, the first database of the CML content was published in 2004 using the ELISA immunotechnique method by a scientist and his team, Goldberg et al. And they presented the data of about 250 foods. Then this list of 250 foods suggests that food products with high CML content are invariably high in protein and fat. Later on in 2010, the CML database was expanded to about 549 foods. And herein, they also studied the impact of cooking methods. This is reported by another group of scientists headed by Yuri Barry in 2010. Then after 2 years, another list of food items has been published in which another 257 foods were detected by another method, UPLC, MS, or mass spectrometry. This was led by another group of scientists. So based on all these analytical methods, what we can infer is that cereals had the highest CML content and fruits and vegetables the lowest content of CML. So what is our daily dietary age intake? Now the D stands for dietary because it can also be endogenous. To distinguish between the food source of ages, I have used the small d as a prefix. Now, the age content has been calculated for healthy people with different age and people suffering from metabolic syndrome and chronic diseases, especially diabetes and kidney disease. And from all the available data, there is a wide range in the daily dietary age intake because we consume a variety of foods which are processed differently. So which can be as low as 4,000 to as high as 24,000 units per day. Now, for the healthy people, a suggestion of 9,000 to 23,000 has been suggested. A daily age intake might be estimated to be around minimum of 9,000 to a maximum of 23,000. The available data from dietary age is based on accurate analytical method. Still, this is limited at the moment because these methods are state-of-art methods and all laboratories will not have the facilities to analyze the dietary advanced glycation end products in the foods. So, so far the known methods are LCMS and ELISA-based methods. So, from the available information, we can categorize foods as low-age foods and high-age foods. Under the low-age foods, you can see the grains, the legumes, the vegetables, the fish, the fruit, and the low-fat milk come under low-age foods. And under high-age foods, invariably all those foods which are animal derived like chicken, beef, pork, and even cheese. Cheese has got both fat and protein in it, and oil also. Like, you know, it is not just oil. Oil along with protein that can result in lipid peroxidation and can lead to the formation of some age products. So here is a list of the foods of I have taken from the available literature. Now you can see here a range of foods have been given. Frozen toasted pancakes per 30 gram serving, 679. Whereas red kidney beans, which have been cooked for 1 hour, don't give that much. It is 298. Homemade pancakes, 292. Broccoli, which is cooked and or boiled, it is only 226. Pasta cooked for 8 minutes. Corn flakes, toasted bagel, baked apple, then whole wheat bread has the lowest. Canned green beans also have the lowest, and white rice also has the lowest. So another list of foods like salmon, this is all the non-vegetarian or the animal-based foods. Here you can see that there is a wide difference between the previous table and this table. You can see salmon raw has 502. When it is broiled for 10 minutes, it doubles. Beef is about 2000. When beef is broiled for 15 minutes, it increases. It is not boiled, it is broiled. Beef, which is stir fried, it further increases. Chicken, boiled chicken will have 1,000. When it is broiled, it increases to about 5,245. Compared to beans, you can see earlier also I showed you about kidney beans. Raw have 116. Even canned beans have got 191. White potato is the lowest. French fries, here is the formation of Maillard reaction. Because of the sugar in the potato interacts with the amine groups and then it results in the dietary age products. So this is quite high. Broccoli is low, tomato is low, and apple, which comes under the list of fruits, is low. So this is just a bird's eye view of what could be the range of age in various products cooked by different methods. So from the available literature, we can infer that dry heat promotes new dietary advanced glycation formation for a range of more than 10 to 100 fold above the uncooked state across various food categories. And animal-derived foods, which are high in fat and protein, they are generally age-rich and they are prone to new age formation during cooking. And on the contrary, carbohydrate-rich foods such as vegetables, fruits, whole grains, and milk, they contain relatively few age compounds even after cooking. And some studies have shown that using a compound called as aminoguanidine, which can inhibit the formation of glycation, and use of moist heat instead of dry heat can result in reduction in the formation of new age products. So here is a overview. You can see a pictorial view of all those food products which can result because of the direct heat contact with the flame and then deep frying, whereas in this product, French fries, and in chicken, or this is broasted and roasted meat. So in all of that, we can anticipate higher amount of age products to be formed. So now with that basic information, let's move on to the second section of my talk, wherein I will be focusing on how do these contribute to endogenous levels. So there are some actions, mechanisms which have been identified at the tissue level and at the cellular level. All these advanced glycation end products are known to promote inflammation and oxidative stress, which is the hallmark for the pathological process of any disease at the cellular level. So the first common action which AGEs can do is they can cause stiffness of the protein matrix and thus alter the function of the protein. It could be collagen, it could be anywhere. For example, cross-linkage of proteins has been studied with respect to kidney diseases, that it can cause renal glomerulosclerosis, atherosclerosis, and it can also thicken the capillary basement membrane. And the second reaction is that there is a receptor for AGE and for advanced glycation end products, which is known as RAGE, receptor for advanced glycation end products. Now, this receptor interrupts cellular signaling pathways, thus causing harmful tissue remodeling. I will be depicting this in a pictorial form later on. Then the third interaction is that lipid peroxidation disrupts endothelial function. It promotes oxidative stress and inflammation, which in turn contributes to the fourth effect, that is a pro-oxidant effect. That is, it promotes the oxidation. So here is a pictorial depiction. You have two sources of AGEs, endogenous and then exogenous. Exogenous coming from the food, endogenous between the interactions between sugar and protein. Ultimately, all of this lead to the accumulation of AGEs, and this can have different impact on the extracellular matrix, wherein it can promote protein cross-linking and altering of the function, and it can affect the extracellular matrix or inside the cell, because of this is the RAGE or the receptor which can send wrong signals to the inside of the cell. So what are the effects of AGE? When there is increased AGE receptor formation, proteins are modified by advanced glycation end products. These, they act as photosensitizers and cause DNA damage. So this in turn can damage microcirculation. And the AGE will form a glue-like substance, which makes the blood vessels become to lose their elasticity. And it promotes inflammation and thus affecting the lipids, the DNA, and the other biological materials inside the cell. So what we understand is that the AGE compounds can act on the receptor for the AGE compounds. So here is a pictorial depiction. See, this is the AGE compounds which are present in circulation or in the interstitial fluid. So there is a receptor and they bind onto this receptor for AGE, and that signal is transmitted to the inside, to the nucleus, to the DNA. But this signal will be wrong signaling. And so as a result of that, what happens is that different products like, you know, NF-kappa or the inflammatory cytokines, TNF-alpha, these will all be produced. So the high AGE containing foods plus Maillard reaction result in AGE products, which can bind onto the receptor, onto this which is present on the cell surface, and this can lead to inflammation and release of cytokines. So the RAGE, receptor advanced glycation end products, the definition are receptors on cells that send wrong signals or messages to the DNA. and RAGES, these are toll-like receptors, like, you know, something you can imagine when you go in a vehicle on a road, you have a toll payment. So something RAGES are also like that. These are cellular pattern recognition receptors that identify molecular patterns of the pathogens. Whenever they are engaged, the net result is an inflammatory response. And this inflammatory response has been studied in depth, especially in diabetes, CVD, and kidney disease. So this diagram also very clearly tells us dietary ages, because we consume the advanced glycation end products through diet, it can lead to serum levels of ages. This will bind on to the RAGE, that is the receptor for advanced glycation end products, results in the activation, activation of nuclear NF-kappa, and this in turn causes a reactive oxygen species, which is the hallmark of oxidation, followed by inflammation. So this has a vicious feedback, like, you know, more and more oxidation, more and more RAGE products, and then it can activate the nuclear NF-kappa. Then apart from that, serum ages are implicated in causing insulin resistance in diabetes and probably hyperandrogenism. Okay, so now with this, we'll move on to the third section. What is the effect on health, and are there any disease-related biomarkers in humans? Now, what we have understood so far is that the advanced glycation end products irreversibly accumulate in cells and tissues of the body. This is a fact we should accept. So why are we so concerned? If they are in circulation, they will be eliminated either through the fecal route or through the urinary route. But we should understand that they can get accumulated in various tissues, thus promoting unwanted reactions. So formation of ages within the body is a normal part of metabolism. And the body has natural processes that eliminate the ages before they can do much damage to the body. Now, the present state of research has shown that high levels of ages in the body can lead to or worsen serious health concerns. So the concerns what we have so far studied in depth are the age compounds are important for people, especially with diabetes, kidney disease, CVD, and in current times, diets which are high in fat, protein, and low in carbohydrates are gaining a lot of popularity, especially for losing weight. Then also they are suggested in the management of hyperglycemia in diabetes, and also for cardiovascular disease patients. Now, this pattern substantially raises the dietary advanced glycation intake, and it can contribute to health problems over long-term use. As I mentioned earlier, age has been studied in detail with respect to diabetes. So let us try and understand what is the relation here. Age formation and their proposed role in diabetes. See, when a person has got persistent hyperglycemia, that is uncontrolled blood sugar levels, so the sugars will be high, and you know, this can lead to formation of non-enzymatic glycation, resulting in extracellular ages, also the intracellular ages. One can come from the diet and another can come from the interaction between the high sugar levels and the intracellular proteins. So ultimately what happens is that there are a lot of age products in circulation. They bind onto the age receptor, that is the RAGE, and they activate many mechanisms. One is activation of cell signaling molecules, protein kinase, or it can interact through nuclear factor also. So ultimately, they will alter the gene expression, or they may alter the protein function, resulting in cellular dysfunction and damage. So it has been reported that diabetics generate more endogenous age products than those without diabetes. And much of the information we have today on ages comes from diabetes research only. And this is probably due to the fact that there is a lot of chronic inflammation, subclinical inflammation happening in diabetes. And there is a very strong correlation between diets high in age compounds and inflammation, which keeps on worsening as you consume more and more, or with passage of time. So in the second condition or disease in which ages have been studied or have been suggested to have an important role is that in renal disease. The fact is, we know that kidneys are the filtering organs. Okay, so they have to eliminate all that which is unwanted. And likewise, here also in the elimination of the end metabolites of age metabolism, kidneys play a key role in elimination of ages in the body. And high levels of ages have been associated with kidney disease. So renal disease, it's a known fact that people who are suffering from renal disease, they have an impairment in the clearance of age from the body. So as a result, it keeps accumulating. It results in more and more accumulation of age compounds. The third disease in the context of which the ages have been investigated is its role in cardiovascular disease. So role of ages and cardiovascular disease has been studied extensively. Now, what does the research suggest is that ages play a role in the development and progression of heart disease, largely because of the process of oxidation and inflammation. And the fourth aspect in which ages are gaining a lot of importance is aging, premature aging, I would say. Now, here are the structure of the skin, the dermis layer and the hypodermis, epidermis and the cuticle. You can see this is the younger skin or healthier skin, let us say, where you have the protein matrices in a specific pattern. And this is the hypodermis. But when we start aging, what happens is the elasticity of the collagen is lost. So here you can see this is distorted and it is broken, disrupted. So the collagen is disrupted. These are the fat cells. You can see more number of fat cells compared to the left-hand side figure. So ages have been linked to premature aging of the skin by breaking down the collagen and elastin, which can lead to premature wrinkles. So this is yet one more reason why we should avoid or think twice before eating highly processed foods. Okay. Now, how can you, is there a solution? Because everything should have some solution. How can you reduce the speed at which glycation reactions occur? This is a very basic question anybody would ask. So let's try and understand. Yes, of course, there is a solution. Nutrition and nutritional interventions early, if you start it early in the accumulation cycle, is important. So what are those nutritional interventions which we as common man can think of to prevent the accumulation of the dietary derived age products? So in this last section, let us try and look into how to avoid advanced glycation end products and what are the food preparation methods. I would say food preparation is the hallmark to limit age intake. That is how you cook your food. Boiling, steaming, low heat, acidic marinades, they have all been reported to result in lower formation of age compounds. Now, I'm sharing you here the values of two foods. Like, you know, you have chicken and then there is beef. Chicken broiled is resulting in 5,828 per 100 gram. Whereas the same chicken, instead of broiling, you boil, you make a curry or you use a boiling as the technique. It is much lesser. You can see from 5,800, it can be reduced to 1,100. Then broiling the beef is also resulting in 5,963 per 100 grams, whereas stewing the beef brings it to about 2,200. So what is the inference is that low age generating cooking methods are poaching, steaming, stewing, and boiling. So how can we reduce the age intake? Okay, the intake of the advanced glycation end products. How? You can increase the consumption of fish, but not deep fried or broiled fish, but cooked fish, like in a form of a curry, then legumes, low fat milk products, vegetables, fruits, and whole grains. How can you reduce the intake? You have to, by reducing the intake of solid fats, fatty meats, full fat dairy products, and highly processed foods, you can reduce. So you need to increase the consumption of the former and you need to reduce the intake of these other foods which have been listed at the lower half of the slide. So what we understand is that how can we increase the intake? by consuming lesser amount of processed foods, by consuming lesser amount of grilled, fried or roasted food, and use high moisture cooking and marinate meat and fish in low pH solutions. I'll be explaining this. So how can we control the dietary advanced glycation end products? First thing is vary your protein source. Let us not derive our protein only from one single source. Okay. So I'm giving you an example. In 2015, the FDA released one dietary guidelines, and this prompted Americans to replace some of the meat, poultry and eggs with protein coming from seafood and plant-based protein, especially nuts, seeds, beans and whole grain. See, it is very fortunate that our Indian diet is already rich in whole grains, beans and any kinds of legumes. So let us rediscover and go back to the plant-based proteins derived from nuts or seeds and beans. And the second thing is that we need to skip the added sugar. See, we must realize that, of course, sugar is tasty. Any sweet dish or a dessert will be tastier. But the biggest culprit in the formation of advanced glycation end product is sugar, because it is a reaction which takes place between the carbonyl of the sugar and the amino group of the protein or the amino acid. So therefore, we need to skip the added sugar. And apart from that, excessive consumption of sugar will lead to weight gain. And there are a host of other problems, plus increased formation of ages, not to forget that. So the third thing is, what is the practical solution? Cook low and slow, I would say. That is, don't cook at very high temperature. Cook slowly and at low flame. So low heat for longer periods can limit the amount of ages. This has been documented, where there are certain studies where they have compared the cooking of a product by low and slow cooking and high, using high flame and short temperature. And they have found marked difference in the amount of advanced glycation end products formed. So studies have documented that using low heat for longer period can limit the amount of age. And fourthly, using acidic marinades on meats, that can reduce. Okay, like for example, what acidic marinades can you use to inhibit the advanced glycation end products? We have a tendency, most Indian homes, we use either lemon or curd or citrus fruit, citrus juice to, you know, marinate our meat. So instead of barbecuing or adding mayonnaise and eating all these barbecued ones, go in for acidic marinades on meats. And then try and include more amount of fruits and vegetables, to bring in the antioxidant effect, which, as we all know, fruits and vegetables are endowed with. And plus, along with that, they contain very low level of age compounds, because there is no protein in fruits and vegetables. So you cannot expect the age compounds to be generated when vegetables are cooked. Apart from that, they are rich in several antioxidants, and they are also good sources of micronutrients. So these are some of the practical solutions where we can use at home level to control the generation of dietary advanced glycation end products. So at the end, I would say, what is the take home message for all of us? Current data, it supports the need for a paradigm shift that acknowledges that how we prepare and process food is very, very important, equally important as nutrient composition of the foods. And however, we need several more studies to investigate the health effects of ages and recommend safe dietary intake. As far as I know, we don't have any information on the Indian foods which are cooked by a variety of ways. So we have to, I implore upon the younger generation, the research scholars, the young scientists, to undertake and plan studies. This is very important, because ages can have a lasting impact, and they can hasten the aging they can serve as an aging factor in our body, and it can cause premature aging. For those who are diabetic, it can worsen the diabetic situation, and it can even result in early onset of diabetic complications. So therefore, more studies are needed on this aspect to understand the health effect of ages. And therefore, we can even come up to some solution to suggest safe dietary intakes. So thanks a lot for your patience in listening to this talk on advanced glycation end product. And on behalf of my department, I welcome all of you to visit my department once. And then I also extend my heartfelt thanks for inviting me to deliver this talk today. Thank you so much.
Good nutrition is the science of food and its relationship to the health. Thank you, ma'am, for such a nice presentation, and it's very informative to us. Hope it will enrich all of us. Now I would like to place few questions in front of you.
Sure.
That we have received from our participants.
Yes, welcome.
First question is from Priyanka Mondal. What is hyperandrogenism?
Hyperandrogenism. See, we have got different types of hormones in our body, right? And some of them are not involved in what we call them as sex hormones. You have estrogen, you have progesterone, you have testosterone, isn't it? So secreting more amount of androgen-based hormones is a condition which is known as hyperandrogenism. Whereas more amount of testosterone is formed in the body of a female. So that can result in masking the feminine characteristics, and it can even bring in an imbalance in the steroid hormones.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another question, ma'am. How does glycation affect the nervous system?
How does the glycation affect the normal system? Yes, good question. I think I tried to, explain this in my earlier part of the talk. See, glycation products, they are not new. It's not that they are happening only now. They have been part of they are generated because we subject food to different types of cooking. And Maillard reaction is a very common reaction which takes place in foods which have got sugar and protein in them. Okay, it results in a nice flavor. See, your cake, your cookie, your biscuit, your bread, all of them give you the typical flavor, aroma, and color. And that is because of Maillard reaction products. And these are glycation products. Okay, but if you keep cooking if you burn your toast, one, the taste will be spoiled. Apart from that, lots of glycation end products are formed, so that you may not like to eat. Even if you like to eat, it can get accumulated in your body. So now, because we are using a lot of processed foods, the impact of dietary advanced glycation end products is gaining a lot of momentum. Okay, that is why more importance is being given. People are identifying what are and trying to take note of what are glycation end products. I hope I have answered the query.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Hello. Ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Yes.
The next question, what foods are low in ages?
Yes, see, all those foods which are not cooked at very high temperature. Okay, see, first of all, you need to have two things in your food for generation of glycation end products. One is the carbohydrate or sugar, and then the protein or the amino acid. So invariably, foods which are animal based or high fat milk based product, cheese, etc., these are the ones which are more prone to formation of higher amount of age products. Whereas cereals or pulses, legumes, vegetables, fruits, and all the vegetarian foods, they are not known to generate high amount of age products. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Another question. How can we reduce advanced glycation end products?
How you can reduce? Yes. See, as I mentioned, these are all product of thermal processing. See, when you have cereal flour and you eat raw, it will not generate in the formation of Maillard reaction. But when you apply, you make chapati. Let us imagine it is chapati. But you are not going to cook chapati at 200 or 300 degrees centigrade, not for half an hour or 1 hour. It is only for a restricted time and at a temperature, okay, on the tawa. This will not generate in the formation of age products. But when you are baking it at a very high temperature for a shorter duration, that is HTST, what we say, high temperature, short time, this can result in the formation of aged products. So what we need to know is that highly processed foods, dry heat is the one which results in formation of aged products, whereas moist heat, low cooking at low flame will not result in a high amount of aged products.
Okay, ma'am. Hello. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Then another question is, what is the difference between boiling and broiling?
Yes. See, boiling, we put it in water and we, cook the food, isn't it? Now, broiling is a different, it is a slightly different from that, where you use minimum amount of water and you use lot of dry heat to cook that. So therefore, what happens is that the surface of the food will acquire that brownish color, whereas in boiling, that brownish color is not obtained.
Okay, ma'am.
Hello, hope I'm clear.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. I think I don't miss any important questions. As no more questions are there, on behalf of organizing committee, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Asna Uruj, ma'am, for accepting our invitation in spite of her busy schedule and enriching us. We are delighted to have you among us today. Thank you, ma'am,
for your time. Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, it is over to Shreya, madam, for next part of this session. Thank you.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhusri. Thank you so much, Dr. Asna Madam, for your nice and informative presentation. Now, I would like to introduce our second honorable speaker, Dr. Neelam Yadav Madam. Welcome, ma'am. Professor Neelam Yadav has done her PhD from Banaras Hindu University and currently working as professor in food technology and director of Institute of Professional Studies, University of Allahabad. She has section of diverse organizations, namely Rajasthan Agricultural University, Udaipur, and BAGU, Varanasi. She started her career as assistant professor from Allahabad Agricultural Institute, Allahabad, and later joined Center of Food Technology at University of Allahabad as associate professor and elevated to professor in 2015. She has the distinction of being an erudite scientist and a capable administrator. She contributed significantly in food science and nutrition education by upgrading syllabus and introducing new academic programs in the discipline and serving as an expert with various institutes and organizations. Her research interests include micronutrients, grain science, and value addition. Her research work in the area of iron and zinc has been cited well in various scientific publications. Dr. Yadav has supervised 6 PhD students and more than 60 students. She has 50 publications in national, international journals and edited one book, 10 chapters in textbooks, and has developed scientific material. Has been investigated by project funded by DFT, ICAR, and UPCAR. She is in editorial board of 4 journals. She has organized several workshops, and special courses and conferences in her field as convener and coordinator. She has presented papers in several national and international conferences as delegate as well as invited speaker. Professor Yadav is also working as executive director of NABL accredited food analysis and research laboratory at of food technology, also a nodal lab aside. She has been instrumental in establishing this lab in the year 2013. Yadav also established local chapter of Association of Food Scientists and Technologists in the year 2016 and currently holding post of President of Allahabad chapter. Welcome, ma'am, again. Her topic of today's webinar is micronutrients in human nutrition and health. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. Now, I request Dr. Neelam Yadav, madam, to deliver her talk. It is over to you, ma'am. Please.
Thank you so much for such generous introduction.
Thank you.
Just a minute, I'm just sharing.
Okay, ma'am.
Are you able to visualize the presentation and I'm audible?
Yes, you are audible and visible. Hello? Also, clearly.
And the presentation is also there?
Madam, you are audible and visible clearly.
Okay, thank you so much. So thank today's talk, as you have already told, is the micronutrients in human nutrition and health. As we all know that we need many nutrients to sustain a healthy life, many of them are macronutrients and some of them are micronutrients. There are 45 essential nutrients which we require, and like carbohydrate, fat, protein, vitamins, they are protein, carbohydrate and fat, they are macronutrients, whereas vitamins and some of the minerals are micronutrients. It is not necessary, as we all know, that these perform some important function in the body for giving energy, growth, and regulation and metabolism. But it is not necessary that a person who is apparently healthy may also be having sufficient status of micronutrients. So today's talk is emphasized on that. So let us see what is micronutrients and how they are different from macronutrients. Usually the requirement of macronutrients are generally large in our body, maybe in grams, and micronutrients are usually required in lesser amount in milligrams and micrograms, and generally vitamins and minerals falls under these categories. All the vitamins come under the category of micronutrients, and as far as the minerals are concerned, the minerals which are having in our body more than 0.05% in the human body, like calcium, sodium, potassium, they are classified as macrominerals, where those who are in our body in less than 0.05% are classified as micromineral. Under these categories come, which we will be discussing, like iron, iodine, zinc, copper, etc. Now, these are some of the functions which all of you might be already knowing. For example, vitamin E acts as an antioxidant, vitamin K required for clotting of the blood, B vitamins required for coenzymes, and C for collagen formation. And of course, I'm skipping these. Since it is not possible to discuss all the micronutrients, so today we will be discussing some of the commonly recognized or those micronutrients which are very important from public health standpoint of view. That means their requirement is not only essential, but their deficiency is widely prevalent across the world. That is why they are of a major concern. These are iron, zinc, iodine, vitamin A, vitamin D, and folic acid. And as the WHO has already told that is affecting a large population throughout the world, of course, more in the developing countries. And these micronutrients are not only required for maintenance and regulation, but for example, they have some very important functions like immunity, brain development, etc. And their requirement is not sufficient. Its requirement changes as the body's condition. For example, if body come across the infested with some infections, their requirement also increases. And if you find out the latest data, there are a lot of data which is available on the malnutrition, but there is lack of data when we refer about the macronutrient deficiency. We will be going each micronutrient, then we will be discussing the data also. Now, what are the causes of these micronutrient deficiencies? There are some social, political, and economical causes where the excess of these micronutrients may not be available. So that may be one cause. There may be some underlying causes, for example, inadequate health status. Just now, as I have told, if somebody is living in a poor, unhygienic condition and may come across with the infestation of some infections, then the body's requirement of infection may be more. Body's requirement for these micronutrients will be increased as body has to fight against these infections. There may be also chances of insufficient excess. So this may lead to inadequate intake of vitamins and minerals, and it may cause the micronutrient deficiency. So what will be the why it is of such great concern? Because these micronutrient deficiency leads to poor immune response. It contributes to poor growth. It is both physical growth as well as intellectual growth. As we all know that some of the important micronutrients like iodine, zinc are required for the growth of the brain. For example, as we all know that in the first year of the life, the 70 to 80% brain cells, that is division of brain cells, already occurs. So it is some irreversible changes that cannot be make up. And that point of time, that particular micronutrient is very important, for example, zinc. And that is why we advocate to give more of the colostrum. And thirdly, it may also cause many infections, particularly acute respiratory infections and diarrhea, which may lead to common causes of infant mortality. For example, vitamin A is very much required to prevent the acute respiratory infection, and zinc for diarrhea. These micronutrient deficiency has also been given a name, hidden hunger. Why we call it hidden hunger? Because it is a form of undernutrition and which usually occur either due to poor intake or the poor absorption in the diet, and which may lead to poor health, and that is why it is called hidden hunger. So these are some of the common micronutrients like iodine, iron, vitamin A, and zinc. And these are the number of people affected by them. This is the 2014 and 2009 data. We'll be seeing further. Now, what are the causes? As we have discussed, why the people are more prone to these micronutrient deficiency? One big challenge associated, particularly in case of mineral, is the poor bioavailability. Now, what is bioavailability? Bioavailability is the amount of nutrients absorbed by the body and utilized by it. For example, if we see that how much, particularly minerals, they are very, they are absorbed in very less quantity, or I would say their bioavailability is very poor. For example, we have two crucial nutrients. One is iron, you can see, another is zinc. Why? And mostly the Indian diet, as the previous speaker was saying, that most of us are dependent on the vegetarian diet, and particularly vegetarian diet is poor in bioavailability of these nutrients. For example, if we see the iron, our 80% of food, only 10% of that is absorbed. That means if you are in having 100 milligram of iron, only 10 milligram of iron is available to the body. And similarly, of course, zinc is little better. Its bioavailability comes between 30 to 40% in our experimental data. Also, we have seen this. Now, why this bioavailability is poor? Because of the certain interfering substances, as in the below, I have mentioned that, for example, in case of iron and zinc, phytate is one important interfering substance. Phytate is present in most of the cereals and pulses, and they are the major source of our iron and zinc in the diet. So the phytate is present in 2, 3, 4, and 5 forms, the valency form. So it has a very good chelating agent. So what happens, it also chelate with the iron as well as other minerals. So if the phytate to iron molar ratio is more than one, that it shows that it is a poor bioavailability. And similarly, in case of zinc, if the molar ratio of phytate to zinc is more than 15, it shows a poor bioavailability. And most of the Indian diet, when it is taken without special processing, then it has a very poor bioavailability. So coming to the iron, now let us see, we'll discuss one by one. Iron, as we already know, it is an essential component of two important constituents of the body, hemoglobin and myoglobin, required for many enzymes, particularly electron transport system, which relates to the oxygen transport. This iron exists in two forms in the food. One is the heme form, that is called heme iron, and another is the non-heme iron. Heme iron is present in most of the animal foods and easily bioavailable, whereas the non-heme iron is found in the plant food and its bioavailability is very good. Just now we have seen it is between 7 to 10%. Function of the iron we are already aware of. It's a very good it is a transport of electron, it's a carrier of oxygen, it is very good detoxifying agent, particularly in the liver. It is also required in the single control of neurotransmitter, such as the function of the dopamine in the brain, which is also one important ingredient for the one important function for the immunity. And of course, the other now consequences of the iron deficiency. The consequence of the iron deficiency is very wide spectrum of problems may occur, especially depending upon the person to whom it is affected. Like as we have, we will see in the upcoming slides that prevalence of iron deficiency is particularly high among the high demand group. For example, the pregnant women and women and the preschool children and women of the reproductive age group. So its effect in the pregnant women, the outcomes may have a very bad effect. For example, it may lead to the perinatal mortality. It is one of the most single cause of low birth weight. LBW 80% contribution is because of the low iron store intake of the mother. And even if the mother intake is less, the storage of iron will be less in the liver of the infant. Other than that, it also affect the physical performance. For example, reduced physical activity, the work output is less. It also impairs the cognitive development. Not only development, the cognitive performance has been found to be affected in many research studies. The academic scores have been found to be very low. So it may lead to poor learning ability and decreased work output, low birth weight. And here, this is the global data which shows that WHO 2016 data shows that across the world, 32% of the non-pregnant women and 40% of the pregnant women are having iron deficiency anemia. And according to the 2018 data, this is a very surprising, or I would rather want to stress on that, has risen, as most of the micronutrient deficiency we have been able to overcome, and there is a trend of decline in the prevalence of these micronutrient deficiency. But anemia is one thing which is rather constant or is slightly increased. The Global Nutrition Report 2018 has shown a slight increase. This is the NFHS data 4, which was conducted in 2015. You must be aware that National Family Health Survey, we have 4 and we are waiting for the 5th health survey, which tell us the report of the India. And you can see that the percent is very high among the preschool children and also among the adolescent girl. It is ranging between 50 to 60%. So that is comparatively very high. So it is not only affecting the health of these person, but as well as the general outcome is also affected. This is the prevalence of low birth weight in India. This is the pool data, 16% are, of course, there has been an increase. This is the pool data. There has been decrease in the low birth weight, but yet it has to be come down to further because we have to work on this iron deficiency. And now, see, what are the indicators of iron deficiency anemia? One thing we already know that hemoglobin is decreased in iron, but there are certain other indicators which may be taken, which may be alarming situations, or which may give us a prior information. Like example, serum ferritin, which is also decreased. Serum is also decreased. Transferrin saturation is decreased. Total iron binding capacity is increased because there is no iron to bind with. So it is more in amount, but the protein is there, but there is no iron to bind. And soluble transferrin receptors are also increased. Ferritin in protein, ferritin is a protein iron which tells you about the stored iron present in the body. So now, what are the causes of anemia in India? Why it is high? One cause, we have already seen that the biology is very low. The food which we include is also not rich in iron. We have less of the enhancer in the diet. We include less of the fruits, citrus foods, because we all know that vitamin C reduces it into a ferrous form, and ferrous form is easily absorbed. Whereas the tea, coffee, phytate, calcium-rich food, even the calcium is an interfering substance with the iron. So tea, coffee, because of its tannin content, interfere in the absorption of iron. Calcium, rather here, I would like to stress those who are on the supplementation of calcium and iron, they should not take it together. Like in the morning, they can take iron or calcium and vice versa in the evening or within a gap of 4 or 5 hours. Iron losses in Indian studies have been found to be more because of the these menstruation losses and more parity, less gap between two children, that leads to the poor iron storage and some of the other causes. One important cause is like parasitic infections are also very high in India. Worms, malaria condition, they are prevailing very high. And of course, some of the social culture practices like teenage pregnancy and poor family planning is one of the contributory factor. Now let's see the iron content of some common food. Why I want to stress these things? Because as we know, its availability is only 7 to 10 for the pregnant women and the fetus life, for the brain development, for cognitive development and for growth. And its deficiency leads to wide spectrum of disease. And of course, the food sources, we all know that most of these seafoods are very good sources, and its deficiency has led to poor IQ. These are some of the causes of iron deficiency disorder. One is the environmental factor. We already know that's in the hilly areas. Beside hilly areas, the goitrogen is one important factor. There are certain substances, certain food substances, food itself and high iron content, they act as a goitrogen. That means they interfere in the utilization of iodine. For example, all the cruciferi families, many of the roots, cyanides which contain, they may all have an interfering substances. So they may act as a goitrogen and they may lead to iodine deficiency. Some of the spectrum is, we all know, stillbirth, defects in the fetal growth, goiter, criticism, these are the deficiency spectrums. And the assessment of the iodine deficiency disease, and goiter is just an iceberg of that. That means it's just 25% people may be having goiter, rest may be having many other problems. So its deficiency may be assessed with the prevalence of either goiter, or the best method may be the uridine iodine excretion. And even the iodine content of the water can be taken. If it is less than 2 microgram per liter, you can suspect that this area may have a endemic of goiter. The requirement ranges between 19 to 200 microgram per day. You can see that its requirement is quite high in pregnancy and lactation. The iodine deficiency disorder, this is the International Council data which shows these three, first grade 1, grade 2 is the type of goiter, and this is showing the amount of salt used. During the survey, the amount of salt, the amount of iodine by the population who are using this salt, you can see that you must be aware that it is iodine has been covered under the universal fortification program. It is compulsory, and in the fortified salt should be minimum 15 ppm. At the production level, it should be 30 ppm, so that when it reaches to the population, at least they get 15 ppm of the iodine. So the survey shows that approximately 10 to 50% people are having salt which are containing less amount of iodine, less than 15 ppm of the iodine in different states of India. Next is the vitamin A. We all know vitamin A is required for healthy eyesight. It is also, it has an important immune function, and its deficiency may lead to different stages of eye problems, white dot spots, night blindness, etc. And it is the latest data, 2005 data, shows that it is one of the major preventable cause of blindness. That means we can prevent blindness by giving vitamin A, because approximately 30% of the children under less than 5 years of the world may have this problem. Of course, that is 2015 data. It has come down. It has come down to a significant extent, and we have overcome these micronutrient problem. This is the data, which 2016-12 data of NNMD, which shows the prevalence of the white dot spot. That is, we all know there is a formation of white dot spot due to its deficiency, and we can see it ranges from 0 to 1.4%. Vitamin A has that absorption and metabolism issue. We all know that vitamin A is present in the retinol form or retinal form in the animal product, whereas the plant product is present in the beta carotene. So beta carotene, if it has to perform the function of retinol or retinal, it has to be converted into carotene. Carotene has to be converted into the retinol form. So there is a problem in absorption or metabolism, or I would say it is not as readily absorbed as the retinol form. So it's almost 50% loss is there in the absorption, and rest 50% loss or more than that is in the conversion in the liver. So that is why when we are calculating the requirement of beta carotene, its requirement should be 8 times more than the retinol, because the conversion factor, which ICMR 2000 has 10 has recommended it 1:8. Of course, this was 1:4 earlier, but the newer studies tell it should be 1:8. And so is the requirement. The requirement is just the 8 times in terms of beta carotene. Of course, that does not mean that beta carotene is not having important function. The beta carotene form in the diet is equally important. Why it is equally important? Because it has a very good antioxidant, and it requires not only for growth, it is required for prevention of many degenerative diseases like cancer, cataract, and CVD. So other than retinol form is required for, beside the site-related function, it is required for growth, it is required for gene expression, it is very good immunity enhancer, particularly when we talk about the respiratory diseases, and of course proper reproduction. Next is the vitamin D. This is one vitamin which has not been explored to much extent, and we have very limited data. We all know that vitamin D has important function of absorption of the calcium in the diet. How it helps in the absorption of the calcium? Because it sends, it is hydroxyl form, send message to the hormone, and hormone give generation of the protein which can bind with the calcium, and that's how the calcium is readily absorbed. But beside its bone related function, it has very, very other important functions. For example, it is required for the prevention of certain degenerative diseases. Like here we can see vitamin D improves the pancreatic function through the induction of synthesis of insulin in the islet of Langerhans. So it is very much required for prevention of diabetes. Not only that, it is also required for the inversely affect the prevalence of all metabolic syndromes. What are those metabolic syndromes? Like hypertension, obesity, type 2 diabetes, and CVD. And its inhibition has been associated with immunity. It has very important function, like inhibition of generation of pro-inflammatory cytokines to decrease the systemic inflammation. We'll see later on. Like whenever there is some infection, there is the generation of course, the antibody antigen reactions, and certain inflammatory cytokines are also generated. So vitamin D helps in controlling those that actually leads to autoimmunity. Cells try to engulf themselves. So beside that, this is some important data of the AIIMS, which tells that 5.5% of the women in the country are only sufficient, and the rest are deficient, and this may be one cause for higher prevalence of diabetes, obesity, and cholesterol. And there are surprising data in the next slide. But one thing we already know, why vitamin D deficiency has to be talked in, particularly in respect to the Asian countries. We all know that vitamin D is present in the, of course, the active form is the D3 form, which is the biologically active, that is cholecalciferol form. And it is the form which can be converted with the help of UVB light. See here, it's only the UVB light which can convert vitamin inactive form to the active form. So most of the time, D3 form is present only in the animal food. Of course, in the plant food like yeast, mushroom, the D2 form is present, that is ergosterol form. So that also has to be converted into the active form when it has to have a biologically active, because it also acts as a hormone. So in a hormone form, the D3 form, that is cholecalciferol form, should be there. Now, its sources are very limited. And secondly, the skin is particularly if we talk about the dark colored people, we can see that we have to expose 5 to 10 times longer to the sun because of the more amount of melanin. Melanin limits the penetration of UVB. Light. So we have to be exposed to the higher period of time to the sunlight so that we have a better vitamin D conversion in our body. And that is why the prevalence of vitamin D is very high in the Asian countries, though we are having very limited data. Here you can see some of the studies which have been conducted throughout India. Some of the results are very surprising. For example, Himachal Pradesh, 93% people have the problem, means they are having less vitamin D level, and this range from 80 to 58, and other also similar 80 to 90% people. And vitamin D deficiency among the children, we have latest CNNS survey, that is Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey, whose report has been declared in the January this year only. They show that the 14% of the preschool children, 18% of the school-going children, and 24% of the adolescent are deficient in vitamin D. And this is playing a very important role in the immunity also. So we have to think for that, and we have to come up with more and more studies related to, because we are having very limited data of vitamin D. Next is folate. Folate or folic acid, we all know, this is an B vitamin. And it is required for maintenance of the new cells. Actually, its folate is required for the DNA synthesis. It is responsible for transfer of the single carbon atom. So wherever there is a growth or DNA synthesis, of course, wherever there will be cell growth, there will be DNA synthesis, and folic acid will be required. And that is why it is also required for the maturation of the RBC. So it is a very, very crucial nutrient wherever in the life cycle we talk about the growth. And the rich sources, of course, it is present in plenty in the vegetables and other foods like pulses, etc. In the Western population, particularly in America, folate deficiency is very much prevalent, and it creates a lot of problems. We know it has two important deficiency causes. One is the neural tube defect. Folic acid is one vitamin which is said to be very important for the fetal growth. Why nowadays it is recommended that those who are planning for the family, they should start taking folic acid prior to that. Because what happens, the maximum cell division takes place in the fourth to sixth week of the week after the conception. And those those cell growth or multiplication or cell growth is irreversible changes, because at that time point of time the folic acid requirement is very, very high. The organ formation takes place, and whenever there is a deficiency, what happens? The folic acid is not available for the closure of neural tube defect, and it becomes an irreversible change because there is a competition between the cell for the requirement of folic acid of the CVD and other organs and this neural tube. So this leads to some serious problems like spina bifida. And if the folic acid content is good, it may reduce the risk. You can see like the RDF folic acid for an adult is 200 microgram, whereas during pregnancy, it's just more than double, 500 microgram, because of the growth. And second, very important function of folic acid is in the prevention of cardiovascular diseases. We have one sulfur-containing amino acid, methionine, which is where the folic acid is required, because required for the synthesis of methionine from the homocysteine. Homocysteine deficiency may lead to high methionine is required for the synthesis of homocysteine, and its deficiency may lead to the higher level of homocysteine in the blood. If the high levels of homocysteine are higher, it may lead to cardiovascular disease, particularly it aggravates the atherosclerosis process. Next is the vitamin C. Of course, the deficiency of vitamin C is less, but the vitamin C is very important because we know it has three very important functions. Body cannot synthesize because its structure is quite close to the glucose, but many animals can synthesize it. It is a very good reducing agent, or we can say it's a very good antioxidant. So it helps in fighting infections, etc. It is a very good antioxidant. It is required in collagen formation, and it helps in the first line of defense, the collagen and all the epithelium cells. And that is why even the vitamin C doses are required in very high amount whenever there is infection. The studies have shown that even the normal requirement of the RD is just 40 milligram, but when we come across to severe infections, its doses may even increase to the 200 milligram, or the reports have also told one gram of vitamin C supplementation in such conditions. And of course, the sources I need not tell. We all know these are some good sources. Guava, Indian gooseberry, amla is one of the richest source. Of course, berries are also a good source of that. And it is also required for, since it clears the free radicals, it is also required for whenever its amount increases, whenever body comes in contact with some of the pollutants and toxins. Those who are working in the factories or living in more polluted area, their requirement of vitamin C should be higher, or they should take more amount of vitamin C. Here are some of the effects of demographic factors are very important. For example, this is the new studies which have come up, which show that socioeconomic status in the lower socioeconomic status and lower social class, the intake of the vitamin C rich sources are very less. The nutrient dense food are very less. And even the institutions like boardings, for old age home, there also it has been found that the vitamin C status has been very poor, whereas the requirement should be high, particularly during the old age. So this may be one reason, and this may be one cause of susceptibility towards the infection, because it may impair the immunity. So besides geographical area, the socioeconomical factor, geographical area, season, climate, they all also important factor. And pollution, as I've just told, is the requirement may enhance the exposure to pollution may enhance the requirement of vitamin C, because it may create more oxidative stress, generation of more free radicals in the body. So more of vitamin C will be required. Selenium is another very important antioxidant, though its requirement is very less in the body. Approximately the RD is 55 microgram of selenium is required. So it's like a in a very less amount, but it has a very, very important role to play. One is it's a very good antioxidant along with vitamin E. It is an essential trace element, and it increases the risk of the disease of heart and diabetes. It has a very important role to play in the diabetes and heart disease. It clears the excessive reactive oxygen species in the body, and its prevalence, it is a very good antioxidant. So it also reduces the LDL, low density lipoprotein, which is also called bad cholesterol. So it clears that low bad cholesterol with a biomarker of free radicals in the body, or biomarker of the aging or all degenerative diseases. So selenium, its presence is there in the selenoprotein P, which is mainly present in the plasma, and it clears the, it has a role to play in LDL oxidation, or rather the prevention of oxidation of LDL, so that less of the reactive oxygen species are formed in the body. So these are some of the data associated with the intake of some of the micronutrients in the India. For example, we can see the intake with reference to the RDA, and how much percent of RDA the Indian population is fulfilling. We can see that, but here we have to remember that this is with the RDA. As I've told, whenever a body is in stress, the requirement of some of the micronutrients which has role to play in the immunity is maybe more higher. Now, in a very brief, I would we also like to emphasize on the synergistic role of the micronutrient in maintaining the optimal immune function. Now, what is immunity? Immunity is a body's capability to resist against infections, toxins, pollutants, and this ability is called the immunity. And we all know that this immune system, our immune system, is a complex system, and basically it not only recognizes the pathogen or foreign material, but it also responds and it removes by various methods. And we all know that we have two types of immunity: innate immunity or non-specific immunity, and another is acquired immunity. Innate immunity, we all know, is through various sources, like it may be through various enzymes, bile, which are secreted, even your tears, your skin, sweat, all these are the part of innate immunity. And some of them are like phagocytic cells, dendritic cells. They also are the first line of defense. And here, the micronutrient has very important role to play, both for innate. The other type of immunity is the acquired immunity, which is very specific immunity, and it is again of two type: humoral and cell mediated immunity. Humoral immunity, it provides it is particularly the cells like antibodies, B lymphocytes, and cell mediated immunity is related with T lymphocytes and T cells. Now, what is the role of micronutrients in the immunity? Basically, these micronutrients play a role in three ways. First, it helps as a barrier. They are epithelial barrier, and here the major micronutrients are vitamin A, vitamin C, E, and zinc. Cellular immunity, that means where there is a certain reactions occurs in the body. There is a generation of cytokines. There is a generation of interleukin. And that's lymphocyte formation and generation of inflammatory, pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory substances. And basically vitamin A, vitamin C, vitamin B complex, vitamin D, folic acid, iron, zinc and copper has an important role to play. And the third function it performs by antibody reactions. Antibody-antigen reactions, and basically vitamin A, folic acid, zinc, vitamin D, copper, selenium has important role to play. In a very brief, we'll see, like the first function is the physical and biochemical barrier. Physical and biochemical barriers, we know the mucus cells are the first line of barrier, which may prevent the infections, again, all the pathogen whether it is a virus or a bacteria or a parasite. And this mucous membrane is found in the lungs, in the intestinal cells, as well as in the other portions of the body, like skin. And here, what is the function? For example, vitamin C. Vitamin C, we all know, it promotes the formation of fibroblast, which is required for the collagen formation. Wherever there is an invasion due to the action of the pathogens, wherever there is a damage of the cell, there is again formation of the collagen with the help of vitamin C. Thus, it maintains the functional integrity of the epithelium cells and does not allow the pathogen to enter into the body. Now, zinc particularly is most useful in maintaining the immunity of the GIT system. GIT system, we all know that this epithelium layer, during the course of digestion, it shed off. It's some amount of epithelium cells shed off on a regular basis, and it is regenerated. And it is, the zinc is required in the formation of those cells. It acts as an enzyme there. So it maintains the mucosal membrane of the intestine. And it is also cofactors required for cell membrane repair function. And that is why the zinc is one single cause of, supplementation of zinc may prevent the diarrhea. Even the ICDs in most of the centers, it has been advocated that zinc syrups are recommended for all the diarrheal diseases. And vitamin D, how vitamin D? Vitamin D, as we know, also acts as a hormone, the D3 form, that is calcitriol form. It is it regulates the protein which has antimicrobial action. This is the protein, cathelicidine is the protein which acts against the against the microorganisms. They are also responsible for modifying the microbiota. We know all the bacteria are not harmful. We have very good bacteria. Those are called probiotics. So vitamin D helps in maintaining the microbiota of the GIT tracts. That means it does not kill all the microorganisms. Rather, it prevents probiotic organisms and does not allow pathogen to grow. It's in the gut also. It has an important function against the infection. Then other key role of the zinc. Zinc also plays a role in innate immunity as well as adaptive immunity. In innate immunity, it also clears the reactive oxygen species and it creates the reactive nitrogen species. How it helps? It helps by proliferating because it is required in gene expression.
Now it's okay, ma'am, we can start.
Okay. We were just looking at some of the functions of the vitamins, as I've told that I'll just discuss the vitamin.
Ma'am?
Hello? Yes?
I'm just interrupting. Please start from the slide of zinc, because from that slide it was create problem.
Okay, slide of zinc.
Zinc, yes, ma'am, from this slide.
So as I have already discussed that zinc has one important function in maintaining the barrier through the barrier of the GIT system through the mucosal membrane, that is in terms of innate immunity. Beside that, it also acts as a very good antioxidant and protect ourselves from reactive oxygen species and reactive nitrogen species. It also modulates the cytokine release and proliferation of T cells. It helps in maintaining the skin and mucosal membrane integrity. That's why the doctor usually recommends zinc for better hair and skin growth. And in the adaptive immunity, it has a very important role in the identification and proliferation of the cells. For example, differentiation of the immune cells. So it particularly helps in the production of T lymphocyte and its development, and TH1, that is T helper cells, which is like CD4 cells. Then vitamin C has also a very important role in the innate immunity. Beside the barrier, it also has an important role in the body as antioxidant, with two of the endogenous antioxidant like glutathione enzyme, which is already present in the body, and vitamin E, which is a very good antioxidant. So they all help in generation of in clearing of these free radicals and generation of new cells and promotion of collagen synthesis. They also stimulate the amount of stimulate the production of leukocyte, neutrophils, lympho, and which are involved in innate immunity. Then it has a role of antimicrobial by natural killer cells and chemotaxia, particularly help in removal of the toxins. It is also involved in clearance of the neutrophil. That is also an important part of immunity, because when if the things are not clear up, then again there may be problem in the body. Then in the adaptive immunity, it has very important function. It increases the antibodies in the serum. It has a role in differentiation of the lymphocytes. Vitamin D, we have already discussed its function as an hormone and as a innate immunity. So I'll just discuss adaptive immunity. In the adaptive immunity, it suppresses the antibody production by B cells and inhibit T cell proliferation. That means these are the inflammatory cytokines. Its suppression is reduced by the vitamin D. Otherwise, inflammation, as I've told earlier, it's maybe like autoimmune sort of problems that may kill its own cell. So some of the immunological effects of the minerals. Zinc, I have already discussed, so I'll discuss the iron. Iron has also altered the immune response by invading the pathogens, because it has involved in a as a catalyst in all the this oxygen carrying all this this electron transport chain. Then it also activates the innate immunity. Then selenium is particularly required in the expression of alpha beta subunit of interleukin 2 receptors, which is involved in T and B lymphocytes. It is also related with the declining of the NKF cells, and it also helps in proliferation of the helper cells, T helper cells, CD4 cell. And copper is also maintains the immune system. It has an antimicrobial property. Among the vitamins, vitamin A and carotenoid, we have already discussed. Vitamin A has an immunoglobulin production, help in immunoglobulin. Then it also helps in B cell activity. It has an important role to play in all the diseases related with the influenza, upper respiratory tract diseases. Then it also prevents the AIDS, measles, diarrhea, and malaria. It has a very important role to play, and that is why vitamin A supplementation is usually given in the immunization program along with the vaccination of measles. Carotenoid, we have already discussed. All the B complexes, particularly B6, B12, and folate, they improve the immune system. Particularly, they modulate the cell immunity of the CD cells, CD8 cells, or natural killer cells. And vitamin E particularly is responsible for innate immunity, because it regulates the dendritic cells, which is important in innate immunity. It also helps in natural killer T cells and B cells, helps in the lymphocyte proliferation. It is very important. Data shows that it lowers the incidence of clinical malaria. So that's how the micronutrients through its critical function, through the T cells, B cells, killer cells, macrophages, neutrophils, they are involved in managing the immunity or infection. So immunity not only deals with the prevention of infection, it also deals with the management of the inflammation, then the clearing off or scavenging the free radicals, and also killing and elimination of the infectious microbes and toxins present in the body, and the also to prevent the damages caused by the immune reactions, and also to regulate the gut microbiota. By these means, it works, these micronutrients works, and particularly the role of few micronutrients are more like vitamin C, zinc, D, particularly when we talk in terms of the infectious disease. So what may be the effect of supplementation of immune function? The studies have shown that whenever the level of these micronutrients decreases in our body, the body becomes more prone to infection, and the supplementation has a very positive effect. Like high doses of vitamin C stimulate phagocytic anti-lymphocytic activity. It enhances the leukocytes, antioxidative properties. Then its high doses help severely ill patient in intensive care recover, helps in recovering quickly. As I have told you, like even the therapeutic doses of 200 milligram, or rather 1 gram, has been used in management of some severely ill patient. In the zinc is beneficial in the management of diarrhea by maintaining the mucosal cells. So it has been seen that it has a beneficial effect in preventing diarrhea. It increases the cytotoxicity. It restores some of the thymine activity. It reduces the number of activated T helper cells. And vitamin D helps in the calcitriol, helps to restore the immunity. And of course, there is no significant effect or biomarker has been found to act on the interleukin-6. So what can be done to prevent these micronutrient deficiencies? There are basically three approaches which can be implemented. One is food-based, another is supplementation, and third is public health. Supplementation approach is for a specific person who are particularly suffering from that particular micronutrient, and that may be for a limited period of time. It may be in the form of some syrups, capsules, or some intensive nutraceuticals. Whereas the best approach or a long-term approach may be food-based approach. Food-based approach may be either by the dietary diversification. That means if you increase the type of food in your diet, it is going to increase the amount of micronutrient. And of course, food fortification I am not covering because another speaker is going to talk on that. But it can be a very good public health approach, particularly in food, if the selection of the food vehicle is good. And the other public health measures may be the education and communication things by which we can improve the micronutrient status or disorder. Food supplementation, as I have told, it is for the targeted population or a selective population, and it cannot be a It can be only a medium-term remedy. It can or a short-term remedy. It cannot be long-term remedy. So it can be advocated for person till it becomes okay, or the level of those micronutrients becomes okay in its body. The best approach is the dietary diversification, and this dietary diversification may be done through various approaches, maybe processing, lesser processing techniques, or the processing techniques which may prevent the micronutrients. And of course, kitchen gardening and other things. So by including variety in your diet, you can enhance the micronutrient content. Fortification is a very good approach, and many new products have come up. For example, the experiment of fortifying iron in the milk is under the experimental basis. And we already know that salt flour has been used for fortification. And biofortification can another approach, particularly not only in terms of enhancing the amount of those micronutrients, they may further reduce the interfering substances. Like earlier I've told, there are anti-nutritional substances like phytate, tannins. By the genetic engineering, the amount of phytate may be reduced, and efforts have been made particularly in wheat, because wheat has very high phytate content. So that can be also an effective approach. So, in the conclusion, I would say that particularly iron, zinc, vitamin D, selenium, these are the folic acid, these are the major micronutrient deficiencies prevailing in the country. And we have a limited data for some of the micronutrients, like vitamin D, folic acid, the data is not sufficient with us. So more research studies are required to be carried out. And of course, these micronutrients has important role to play in the, not only for management of health, but also in the management of diseases. And there should be all the public health approaches can be best method to overcome these micronutrient deficiencies. So, over to the host, I would request them.
Hello. Am I audible? Yes.
Audible.
Okay. Thank you so much, madam, for such nice and informative presentation. We have enriched a lot from your lecture. Now, it is the time for question answer session. We have received a few questions from our participants. Ma'am, can you hear me? Ma'am? Can I present some questions in front of you, ma'am?
I think there is some network problem from ma'am's end.
I think so.
Can wait for a while.
Okay.
Shreya, you take the questions by this time.
Yes, ma'am.
You take the questions by this time. Whenever the line comes, then you can make it to her, okay?
Okay. Yes, hello, ma'am. Yes. Okay, ma'am. Okay. Ma'am is joining again. So some kind of problem there from her end. The problem still persists, so we have to wait for some time, I think.
Hello? Hello? Yes, Shreya, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me, ma'am?
Okay. Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, ma'am. There is some technical problem, I think. Okay, ma'am. Now is the time for our question answer session. We have received few questions from our participants.
Okay, I'll be happy to answer.
Okay, ma'am. The question has asked by Oishorjo Shaha, what is selenoprotein?
What is?
Selenoprotein.
Selenoprotein. Selenoproteins are actually the protein where the selenium acts as a, for example, like in vitamin D also, it initiates the protein formation. So selenium helps in formation of that protein, which is acting against the lowering of the LDL cholesterol. So this, because for many places, the protein is required for particular functions, the peptides and protein. For example, if the nutrient has to be absorbed, it has to be attached with the protein. So similarly, if the selenium has to function for lowering or preventing the oxidation of LDL, then the selenium has to act as an catalyst, or has to be act to generate the selenoprotein. Then only this protein will function as a specific function of prevention of oxidation of LDL.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. Monisha Nath has asked, in case of kidney patients where potassium-rich food are restricted, still they are suffered from COVID-19. Mm-hmm. So how fruits and vegetables are managed in the diet?
See, in a kidney patient, of course, it has to be a particular diet plan which has to be given depending upon the blood value. I don't know whether she's asking about the combination of COVID with kidney disease or what she's asking. But for in general, the COVID patient, all the antioxidant rich things, like three nutrients which I have recommended, vitamin C, vitamin D and zinc, can be very crucial micronutrients which can be given. Of course, she wanted to say probably that some of the foods which are rich in these substances may also be having high amount of potassium, probably she wants to ask, because leafy vegetables are rich in potassium. So there may be alternative source which can be given. Of course, the potassium level have to be controlled by a dietitian through a regulated diet. And beside that, that zinc-rich food can be, of course, the protein should also be restricted, but it can be given in a form of supplementation in the with the consultation with the doctors. The tablets form can also be given, plus the food, for example, which are not having potassium, they can be given, like vitamin D may not be necessarily having high potassium. So because here again, the sodium has to be balanced. So rather the supplemented form of the micronutrients can be given.
Oh, okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Next question has asked by Anushka Mitro. What are the consequences of having vegan diet?
Vegan diet. Okay, very good question. Vegan diet has one problem. Of course, there are a lot of advantage of the vegetarian diets because high protein are also associated with the degenerative diseases like cancer, etc. So many people are switching over to the vegan diet. Vegan diet is one problem in terms of micronutrient, I would say. They are containing less amount of, like for example, vitamin B12. So B12 is one vitamin which is not present at all in the vegetarian diet. So for vegetarian, we are dependent on the microbiota, gut microbiota, or which we call probiotics. So vegetarian should include more of a, they should include some of the probiotic foods in their diet. Either they can, because they are vegetarian, but vegans may not be using all the animal products, including the milk. So that can be a big challenge. So they have to fight out they have to find out some of the cereal-based probiotics where milk is not used. So vitamin B12 can be one factor for vegans. And of course, there may be, but other things can be managed by complementing other things. And vitamin D also by proper sunlight. This two micronutrients can be crucial in case of vacancies. So a lot of probiotic foods may fulfill the vitamin B12 requirement in case of vacancies.
Okay, okay. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. The next question has asked Orpita Gupta. Although it is a common, what is the difference between heme iron and non-heme iron?
See, there is a difference in the structure of the iron. Iron is an elemental thing in the plant. It is performed in the it is present in the form of ferrous or ferric. Whereas in the if you know the structure of hemoglobin, the four ring structure, if you are taking it from the animal food, particularly meat, then it is present in the heme form. That as such, it will be converted into the hemoglobin form. So it is only present in the animal kingdom, not in the plant kingdom. So its structure similar to the hemoglobin structure of our body.
Okay. The next question, are micronutrient supplements healthy?
Can you please repeat the question? Are?
Yes, yes, yes. Micronutrient supplements healthy for us?
Micronutrient supplementation in our slide, I have told you that supplementation cannot be a long-term strategy. It can be short-term or moderate strategies. For example, it depends on your status of that micronutrient and the status of your environment condition. For example, just the RDA may not be sufficient. If you are having some deficiency of particular micronutrients, then the supplementation can be given for a certain period of time. It is always advisable that food-based approach should be followed, but it can be like supplementation. Once you are the levels of those micronutrients becomes okay in your body, then you can switch over to the food-based approach. So supplementation can be for a limited period of time or in the management of particular diseases like tuberculosis, infectious diseases, etc.
Yes, yes, ma'am. The next question is, how human gut microflora helps in the prevention of micronutrient deficiency?
Yes, very good question. The gut microflora, the gut or the beneficial microflora which are present in our body, they synthesize many of the micronutrients, particularly the B complex. So, like as I've just told, vitamin B12 is synthesized by these micro, and vegetarians are dependent on the synthesis of the B12 from this microbiota only. So, they are synthesizing vitamin B12, vitamin B6, to some extent, other B complexes also, and potassium. Vitamin K. So, that's how they are helping us in maintaining or the requirement of B complexes in our body. Other than that, there are many, many other benefits on which an entire talk can be arranged for that provided.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Next and the last question has asked by Pushpita Dash. A very interesting question, actually. Ma'am, what are career opportunities in food technology? Do the students of your department have any assistance in treatment? What are the career opportunities?
I couldn't get the question. There is some problem in. Can you please repeat it? What are?
What are career opportunities?
Career opportunities in food technology.
Technology department.
Okay, very good question. And in the present context, if you are food technology, there are a lot of career opportunities. One career opportunity in the food industries. Food industry, there are various sections in the food industries where they can be involved. There are sections related with the quality control. There are sections related to the processing. There are sections related to the testing. So in all these three, four areas, they can be involved. They can also be involved if they have an interest in the research. Then they can also be involved in the R&D section of food industries. Then there can be they can be involved in the regulatory functions. Like government has many regulatory bodies. Example, they can become auditors. They can become food safety officers. They can even be absorbed as an analyst in the food testing laboratories. If they have interest in the academics, then they can go for a course teaching, or if they have research aptitude, then they can pursue as a scientist in various or governmental and non-governmental organizations. Then there are certain posts in the government, like food safety officers, this can be involved in that. And they can also be associated with the food marketing sections, which are dealing with the nutraceutical and food. And I'm very happy to let you know that if you, in the COVID period, if you see the economy, it is only the food industry, the packed food has gone 3-4 times the production, because they are not able to give the supply. The production has been enhanced and the sale of these food products has been increased. So this is one industry which is doing well in this lockdown period. So there are ample of opportunities and many, many more opportunities which can be searched. He can become its own entrepreneur, can open their own industry as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am, for answering these questions. No more questions. Yes, ma'am. As no more questions are there, on behalf of the organizing committee, we are really grateful to both of Professor Asna Uruj ma'am and Professor Neelam Yadav ma'am for their consent and nice presentation. Thank you so much, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I'm looking forward to have you among us in future. With that,
welcome to visit our center also. And thank you so much for giving the opportunity and interacting with you all. And congratulations organizing such wonderful this webinar, because very good topics have been chosen by the eminent speaker. So congratulations and thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am. With that, we have come to the end of first technical session of this webinar. Tomorrow, we will meet at 11 a.m. for the second technical session. Till then, stay safe and have a nice day. Thank you all. Thank you so much.